Let me tone it down. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I don't know if you know, some of you know that I've been away for about 3 weeks resisting the pneumonia. So I'm a little short-winded this morning, but thank God I'm here. Yeah. Thank God for His healing power and His deliverance. Hallelujah. I thank God. Hallelujah. And I just want to say thanks to all the participants on the program, all the visitors here. Thank you, Brianna. That was my special request. And that lovely duet, God is so good, isn't He?
Yeah.
All the time, He's good. That testimony, I have a lot I could say, but I want to put the speaker up. But a brother and sister did well. God has had His angels encamped around about you. You know that, don't you? Glory to God. We just thank God for your presence this morning, each one of you. Well, I've been waiting for this, and I hope you're waiting for it as well. Our speaker, I met her over 40 years ago. Yes, it was. Over 40 years ago. I think I may have been carrying Derek, pregnant with Derek, and he'll be 45 this year. So we have known each other for many, many, many years. I called her on yesterday and wanted to give a very formal introduction of her. And I say, do you have a biography? She's from Maryland. I'll tell you just like I tell the other people. Just say, I was sooner born, sooner bred. And when I die, I'll be sooner dead. Judy. That's Judy. Well, but I just want to share just a little bit about, I'm not going to go very long because I could probably talk enough about her to give a message, but I'm going to abbreviate it today. I've known her in the capacity of a friend, a co-worker, a supervisor, and as an advocate. If you want somebody in your corner, you can't find a stronger advocate than Judy. She has been a community activist, oh yes, an activist, a volunteer. She has received many accolades and awards, too numerous to mention. She is, we've worked together at DHS for many years. She's a retiree from DHS, 30 years plus, having worked in the capacity of a worker, supervisor, and in administration, and she left her mark there as well. Judy was the president, she was a member, a longtime member of the Tulsa School Board, and was so effective that she became the president of the school board for many years. She's worked actively in the Democratic Party here in Tulsa, and in 2012, she was a delegate to the National Democratic Convention held in Charlotte, North Carolina. She left her mark there, too, as well. There was an article written in the paper about her after that. She is truly a yellow dog Democrat from her heart. If you have ever seen the presentation, well, I know we all have, of the March on Washington in, I believe it was August 1963, that huge crowd, a sea of people, Judy was there. In that crowd. If you look hard, you may see her. One time I saw someone, I said, I think that's Judy. And she, in the 60s, she marched. And I'm not sure if she was participated in the sit-ins or not, but she was there. Has given her life to service for the Lord. And I must digress and say, and she can tell you a little bit more about this. When we worked together, I would share the Lord with her a lot. Didn't even seem to be interested.
No.
Not at all. But I kept trying and kept talking. And I said, something is going to happen one day. to captivate your attention. And I will let her tell you about that. The list goes on and on and on. She has lots of accolades and awards. But as impressive as her resume is, that all pales in terms of her spiritual encounter and her journey with the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. She will tell you about her experience. Ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome my good friend, a longtime friend, Judy Eason McIntyre. Let's stand as she comes. Judy Eason McIntyre.
And let me say, I don't know where Pastor Hill is. Pastor Hill, thank you for letting me come. Poor Pastor Hill in Maryland heard the worst of me years ago when my faith was zero. And they never gave up. You all have real anchors here in this church. I, as Marilyn said, I've known them forever. And forever, they have been consistent in their spiritual life and giving and preaching to others. And what Marilyn did tell you is, as strong as her faith is, she almost gave up hope. And I don't blame her. Yeah, when I talk, you'll see what I'm talking about. Basically, what I want to say, and I want to borrow from the song that the praise group sang first thing when I got here. God is an awesome God. Yes. He is an awesome God. He has been in my life, because that same God took me from darkness to light. But it took the color of pink for me to make that transition from darkness to light. And that light that I'm talking about is spiritual faith. That is the problem that I always had. And I don't know why some of us are born with certain things. It wasn't that I was given the opportunity or raised up in the church. I can remember as a child in Sunday school, I would ask about, well, how did the Red Sea open? Those kinds of questions. And Reverend Ben Hill was my minister. And he would always talk to me about faith and give me the definition. And yes, I understood things unseen. But it never took root with me. It was weak faith. And yet I was in church all of the time. And so God had a mission for me down the road, just like what the Hills told me. But I never believed that I'd find faith. Not real faith. My faith was, okay, maybe it's going to happen. And if it happens, good. But most of the time, I didn't think anything was going to happen. Now, as I said, I grew up in church. I'm an African Methodist Episcopal church, member of Vernon AME Church. And, of course, my parents had me in church morning, noon, and night. So all of the things that I learned were there, but I couldn't ever seem to be able to really, really use them, apply what I had learned. Because as the devil comes to you with all kinds of things that turns your life around, it first started with my daddy, who died at 46. Unexpectedly, within 15 days, he died, and we never found out what happened to him. And that was what I remember the first time that I got mad at God. And as I was leaving the hospital after he died that night, I don't really remember how I got home, but I know I was mad at God, because I said, here's a man that took care of his family, worked. If he ran around on my mother, I don't know anything about it, and neither did she. And yet he died. And I thought, oh, okay. So, we restore that. Then I'll move on to past going to the March on Washington that I went with my church. Not because I understood anything that was going on. I had never been out of Tulsa and the church bus was going. And that's why I wanted to go. And I remember Martin Luther King talking, and I couldn't figure out why he kept saying the same thing over and over. I have a dream. I didn't know what he was talking about. Because I grew up in segregated Tulsa. My parents protected me from all that was out there. And so I did not know. So then when I get, all of a sudden, my name changed from Judy to the N-word, from the teachers. This what that's going on today was there when I was there in 63. It was there when Marilyn Hill went to graduate school and was met by a sign that said, "Hi, N-word." So I had grown up in the church. My parents and Reverend Hill said, go to church. But I went to church and sat down in a pew with, there were nothing but whites. Everybody got up and left. It was, they cleared out. They hadn't even had a chance to talk, know me or dislike me. But they got up and they left. So we add that to the pile. Because at that point I said, what I need church? What I need to go to church for? When these people are acting this way? No faith. And so I operated, continued to operate it, believing that I'm operating on my own, never dreaming that God is still in my life. But I wasn't accepting him. Then we go, I move on, and I think get my first divorce. I've been married twice. Got my first divorce, and that was pretty traumatic, but I really didn't love him, so it didn't really. I knew when I was standing up there that I didn't love him. But when you graduated from college in 67, if you were a pin or engaged, you were going to be an old person. So I married him. 3.5 years, and then 8 months later, I called Dad and told him, we're getting a divorce. That did not add to the power, because I didn't really care anyway. I came home, and it was back where I was staying with my parents, and it was during that time that my father died. And I married, I was dating this other guy, Bernard McIntyre, that I stayed married to for 11 years. I was dating him, and Daddy told me, he said, that boy needs to grow up. He's immature. But I told him, hey, you can't tell me what to do. I'm in love. So, same thing I said with the first. So, anyway, we're talking about darkness to light. Anyway, so when my daddy fell out of bed, I can still hear the sound today, and went to the hospital and he died. It was at that point that my faith and everything went all the way out of the window. I was talking, and when I met Marilyn Hill, I was talking like this. I know there's a God, and I know God is good. He's good to everybody but me. Now you see how foolish you can be? But I really believe that. And so when these storms of life came in my life, I just figured that's just the way it was. I never got down to pray and ask the good Lord for help. In fact, I didn't even know I was in the dark. Because I was getting up every morning, going to work, doing things, seeming to live a normal life. But at the same time, my mother and other folks telling me that I needed to be in church, that I needed to get close to God. In fact, when I was married to Bernard, I'd stay in bed and wait for him to come from church, then we'd go to dinner. That's how far I was away from the Lord. So when poor James and Marilyn met me, I was a shell. I was truly a shell. And James gave me books, I don't know if James remembers that, gave me books on faith because we talked about it. I never stopped searching. I knew I needed it, but I never knew how to get there. And despite the fact that James had given me books, and I did read them, and Marilyn and I talked all the time. We spent more time talking sometimes than working. And Marilyn could not penetrate because there was no getting through to all of the things that had happened in my life that I saw as negative. And so if all this stuff happened, then where is God? I didn't see it in my life. I was too ignorant to know that he was there all the time. So this is where the color pink comes in. It was later in my life that I was diagnosed with breast cancer. Still thinking the way I always thought, why, what's going to be any difference? I spent my time planning my funeral. My mother lives here. I had Marilyn and them. I had all kinds of friends. But I never said anything to them for almost maybe a couple of months. So I planned my funeral down to the casket and who I wanted to sing and the colors and the whole bit. And at that time I was in politics and I kept thinking to myself, ooh, my political enemies are really going to be happy that I'm going to be gone and they won't have to listen to me anymore. So I finally decided to call my friend Ruby Freeman, and some of you may know her. And because her sister had died of breast cancer, and she had no insurance, I was there with her on her dying days. But of course, I'm not thinking anything of when I was with her sister and she was dying. I didn't think anything other than she was dying. So I called her because I thought maybe she might kind of understand because of her sister. And she listened to me. I was telling her the song, the scriptures, and all the things that I wanted at my funeral. And she called me a bad word that began with a B. And told me, are you crazy? You survived that blankety blanket with a lot of adjectives, ex-husband. And it was that point, at that juncture, that I thought, oh, I'm not going to die before him. I don't want to die before him. But I didn't call out the Lord's name. But I slept on what she said. And I thought, you know what? Maybe I'm going to give this faith a try. Because I was truly afraid. Those of us who, or any of you who have been diagnosed with cancer or any disease that might kill you, you're just immobilized for a minute. But I had no faith other than to go into the darkness. Because despite all of the years of living, and I was 61 when I was diagnosed, so that was a lot of living without God. That was a lot of living in the dark. And yet, God still favored me in the things that I did that he shouldn't have. So anyway, I decided at that point that I'm gonna give God a chance. So I said, I am gonna, you know, I remember it. And Marilyn, they may not think that I heard them, but I remember what they had been trying to tell me for years, because they were there at the hospital before I went into surgery, and they prayed for me. And I thought, I'm going to see what this is they're talking about and what others have talked about, and which has driven my mother crazy and some people around me because of my attitude. And I thought, you know, I don't know what's going to happen with this deal, but I'm going to take it step by step and take God's hand and ask Him to walk this journey with me, wherever it takes me. And it was the best thing that I ever did for me. Because one of the first gifts that God gave me was inner peace. Because if you don't find that inner peace, you cannot function. And I did not realize, and if I get emotional, if you're all here, I did not realize what chaos on the outside of the mask that we wear. Oh yeah, I'm raising pain. I'm laughing and talking. But inside, just if you can imagine Swiss cheese, that's probably the way I looked inside, spiritual, full of holes, nothing to sustain me other than to moan and groan and complain. Never about what others, but what about me? You know, things that, the little things that I thought I wanted, you know, didn't happen. Why did Daddy die? All of the things. And I thought, you know what? I woke up and it was truly a miracle, because when that peace came, I just couldn't believe it. I got up and, you know, no, I wasn't running up and down. I got a bad hip, so I wasn't running up and down. Thank you. But I started telling people, this peace came from, I don't know, you know, I mean, I feel so good. And that peace gave me the opportunity to start then thinking and acting and believing and living faith every minute of the day. And learning how, when the storms come, to say, wait on the Lord. Instead of saying, oh, hey, just another thing happened to me. And that's an awful for any of you all out here and young people. Nothing is going to be perfect in life. Things are going to happen. And it is how you handle that that happens to you. And church is the foundation. And God's word is the foundation to sustain you through the many, many, many things that are going to come to your life. And I learned, you know, Jesus did suffer for me. And I'm complaining about nothing. And at the same time, when you've heard time after time in church that God is love, He is. Because if He wasn't love, I probably wouldn't even be standing here. Because a mortal man, when you act the way I acted, shut up, He let her eat cake and move on. And God would have, the human would have nothing basically to do with you. And through it all, He never stopped loving me. And He never, ever stopped rewarding me and giving me not material things, but the ability to be able to first see the light through breast cancer peak. And then to truly be able to do what Marilyn Hill always said, is that you are going to be able to use your political skills to work with others. And it's true. It is very true. But I never thought I would ever get to that point. Because between my father's death, the divorces, and just the meanness of this world that I could not understand, and still have problems, but I put that in God's hands, because that's not for me to understand why some people continue to be mean to other people, groups of people, and nothing seems to happen to them, but my mama told me to leave that one alone. Because I don't want to go back down the road that I've been on. But I've been so blessed, not the titles, but because I finally found that peace. Yes. And I finally have God in my life. Yes. And I finally see life differently. And to know that however dark your life may be at times, that God is there. Like a couple here. We have guardian angels that protect us and we don't even know. We never had the trucks to run us off the road. Those trucks were there. But God was there. And we did not have to go where you went. So never, ever, ever forget, regardless of how dark it gets, there is light. And mine came in the color of pink. Yours may come somewhere else. It may come through a song that this young woman, and I don't like you because you're too thin. But I love your voice. Or it may come through the words of people like Sister Deborah. There's always help out there.
Amen.
There is never a reason to go to the depths that I went. I have been suicidal. I smoked 3 packs of cigarettes a day. I got down to 89 pounds. That's what will happen when you're not with God.
Yeah.
And there's no reason to do that. And despite the fact of being in church, knowing the word, you still have to not let that go and become so common that you don't know how to use it when you're faced with adversity. And attitude has everything to do with what the quality of your spiritual life is all about. Attitude, and if I could have Saunders, if you'll stand, Saunders. Saunders of breast cancer twice. She is president of our breast cancer group. Andrea Van Dyke, who worked with me, is a breast cancer survivor. We're blessed to be here.
Are you a breast
cancer? Oh, okay. Within our organization, we've lost 3-4 women. And every day, the first thing that I do when God opens my eyes that I used to never do is thank you, Jesus, for another day. And whatever comes my way that day, I know that you're here, and I know that I'm going to get through it. And that's the light that I see now that I didn't see before. What a miserable way to live. And despite the fact that I might have been laughing, hugging, and talking and stuff, inside, where nobody knows but you, it's where the chaos will keep you from being full and getting the rewards that God has for you. I am, you know, even with the attitude that I have, let me tell you how good God was when I was diagnosed with cancer. When the surgeon, when I woke up and the surgeon was there, and maybe James prayed this, and I'm going to give him a lot of credit for this, along with the good Lord. She told me, do not let the oncologist tell you that you need chemo or radiation. Didn't have to happen. Don't know anything about it. Read about it, but don't know anything about it. And God was that good in the face of where I had been. So that's a lesson in us forgiving. Letting things go. Stressed and out about being mad about something or someone, let it go. And I know how good God is. I can't, there's not enough time in a day to be able to say how good God is and where He's brought me. And as the old folks used to say, He's brought me a mighty long way. I mean from darkness to light. And give me the light every day. And I thank God every day that He wakes me up so that I can give back like the hills predicted that I would. Now I'm not as articulate as James, and I can't remember all of the scriptures, but I never forget that God is in my life, that God is always there, that regardless of the adversities, however dark it is, there is a light at the end of the tunnel. And it is as close as getting on your knees, standing up, finding a place to pray and ask God, take my hand. Take my hand. Take my hand. And lead me into life, into hope and not despair, into faith and not disbelief, into love and not hate, and into hope. Because without faith and hope, you can't function. So remove all the meanness, remove all of the anger, remove all of the doubt, and your life will be blessed so that you can bless others. And I want to publicly say, thank you, Marilyn. I've been here before. Thank you, Marilyn. Thank you, James. James has given up on me too. I don't blame him. I don't blame him. But I'm a living testimony that people can change. Yeah. And however hard, and however much it seems like they don't hear, they do. I heard. It went in. Couldn't figure out how to get it. So God took charge. And I'm still alive, even though cancer came to my body, but he got rid of it.
Yeah.
And so I say, keep the faith. Never lose the faith. Keep hope. As Jesse Jackson says, keep it alive. And reach out and touch someone else. Because you never know behind that smile what's going on. And I smiled a lot. But there was a lot of pain inside. So I love you, James. I love you, Marilyn. I do. They're the humans who brought me a mighty long way. I didn't listen to a lot of other people. But I listened to them despite the fact that they were pretty frustrated with me. So, thank you for asking me to be here. I hope that maybe you got something out of the message that you can take back with you and that will make your life fuller and always walk in the light. Because God is good. God is love. And pass that on to someone else. Thank you.
Over the years, the 45 years that I've known her, and truly I can say to you, a transformation has occurred. I remember, and I'm not going to preach her message over again. No. The times we used to go out to lunch sometimes and in the car and trying to find a parking space and somebody driving in front of us, and she said, that blankety blank need to get out of the way. They knew we want that parking space. And I would say, Junie, there was another somewhere else. Don't worry about it. And I remember those times when I would share things with her, and she would say, oh, Marilyn, that's just because you get manna from heaven every Sunday. I said, yeah, she said it. And I said, I do get manna from heaven every Sunday. Every day I get manna from heaven. Didn't faze her. But I recall one day after that second divorce, when she was 80-some pounds, coming into my office asking me to pray with her. And I said, you, Brother Buter, I said, you asking me to pray for you? All these times I had shared and all that, and was like, oh, no, So, as I listened to her today, it almost brought me to tears to see. Let me tell you, when you're planting seeds in others' lives, it may seem like it's falling on deaf ears. You keep planting. Keep planting, because some plant, some waters, but God, hallelujah, gives an increase. It's not over until it's over. And I always like to say, it's not over. You've heard the adage, until the fat lady sings. And I said, she hasn't even taken the mic yet. So you keep planting, you keep watering, and you keep it. And when I heard and I understood that what had happened in Judy's life, you don't know, I can't tell it, how, what that meant to me after having known her all those years. And just like pouring water on a duck's back. But you see how it's sucking in. Oh my God, thank you, Judy. I tell you that it was worth it just for one soul. Glory to God, just one soul. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Thank you so much for sharing with us today. Sandra, thank you for coming. Amen. Andrea, thank you for coming. For all of you, the Donaldsons, we're so proud to have you here. They are visiting with us, and all the visitors. And again, I want to say, it's just good. Again, I just want to say thank you. It is such a pleasure to be back among the saints. I told someone that called me, it felt like I had been on Mars. You see, I grew up in church, and when I can't get to church, it seems like something is missing. I was at home, Sister Candy, reading my Bible and meditating, but it was not like being here. It was not like being here. So I thank God today for His healing and His strength and power. Isn't God good? God is good all the time. All the time He is good. Thank you, Brianna, for that song. Isn't she a singing little girl? I mean, young lady. Amen. Pastor is coming at this time. We want to thank Sister Deborah Williams, our president, for orchestrating everything, and really, really appreciate it. And your words are always seasoned with grace. Amen. We really, those were beautiful, beautiful words. And Judy, again, you left us with lots of gems of wisdom. Thank you so much. Pastor's coming at this time. Let's welcome our pastor.
Sometimes I can't always express how I feel to even to my own wife, but she's been a wonderful, 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 wonderful wife. And I really appreciate whatever God has done through us has been largely done because of her support, her love. And we've been on the road a long time. We've been married for 50 years? 53. 53 years. Almost 54. Weren't we inspired today? Weren't we inspired? I don't remember her reading a single scripture, but I guarantee you what she said reflect what God has done in her life. She had a message. She had a word from God. And I was telling, every time she ministers and tells her life story, I almost weep, I always break. It's just so heartwarming. And I just thank God. I never actually gave up on you. You might have thought I had. You know, that's the way faith works, you know. We call the things that be not. So we have to hang in there, you know. If you can't hang, you know, you're not in faith. But she didn't understand all that, did she? But she understands it right now. Like the son said, you'll understand it better. Bye and bye. It was an excellent program. I mean, this is one of the best fifth Sundays we've ever had. One of the best ones. It challenged me, even from the beginning. I just said, God is doing a new thing with our praise team. And to the oh boy, my heart, I was just crying all the way through the prayer when y'all first got up there. And I was back there just showing out in the back. Oh, something just happened. Something is going on around here. All right, and let's get that right, Sister Denise. She didn't get a chance to give her testimony. We have people that have been delivered from aneurysm, heart attacks, and strokes, and all of that. They've been delivered. And we were going to have one today, but time didn't permit. Sister Denise is going to give her testimony next Sunday. And you want to hear that? Aneurysm and how God delivered her. And she's back after 5 years. She's back to her normal self. Please bring this story. She's going to tell it on next Sunday. You want to hear that? And also, Brother Travis, raise your hand. 15 years ago, is that right? 13 years ago, how God delivered him from the streets and from depression and from, he just named drug, just name it. And he's still standing strong. He's going to give his short testimony. You want to hear it? He got saved and filled with the Holy Spirit on Easter Sunday. And he wants to tell it every year. Amen. He wants to tell it every year. So we're going to give him that space on next Sunday. We just appreciate all of our special guests. All of these are my friends, too. All of Sister Hill, well, they're former co-workers with her, but they're my friends, too. We all came through the same ranks. All right. So we are so delighted to have them today. We appreciate, boy, these are some of the best. One of the top supporters of the church. So, you know, God got their back. It means something when you, amen, praise God, honor God with the first fruit of his increase. It means something. Amen. I just thank God. It means to have favor with God. Amen. And God always comes through. He's faithful to that promise. I just want to just say, we just terminated a 40-day consecration. I just feel 15 pounds lighter. And my clothes are 2 inches. What you call it? 2 inches looser. You get a way to put it. Hey, amen. No buttons ain't popping no more. I'm not burning them up. All right. But we just want you to know that we're going to celebrate our 40-day adventure without meat, without sweets, without a whole lot of stuff that we normally eat. Tomorrow night at 7 and Wednesday night at 7:30. We want everybody to be back because this is going to be our breakthrough prayer. Breakthrough prayer. And our Sister Deborah has spearheaded that. She's renowned nationwide for her prayer ministry. Amen. And she's going to come because I think that all of us, after we've heard such a dynamic word from God, we just want to leave with those blessings upon us. And she is going to pray that prayer that will bring completeness and release, whatever you are believing God for, whatever your need might be. Amen. Don't miss this prayer because after all of the consecration, all that, the sacrifice that many of us have made, we can just sense a special anointing in this place. It's a special anointing in this place. And she's going to come and be the foundation. Organized, orchestrated, the prayer, the 40 days, she set it up and she's following through. She's praying behind the scenes. And just a whole lot has gone. Amen. Forth during this 40-day period. She's going to come and she's going to be on TV. I don't know whether she'll be praying on TV on April the 10th, but if they let her pray, she will. All right, Sister Deborah's going to come. And just hang in there. About 10 more minutes.
Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
We're so happy for Sister That message, that was just a beautiful message, Sister McIntyre. I really enjoyed that. And the Lord just spoke some things to my heart that perhaps some are still dealing with addictions, maybe even illness.
And we have learned that an illness may not necessarily be physical, but perhaps sometimes there's emotional healing that needs to take place. How many can say amen? So we want to encourage everybody that needs a special touch this morning. We want to just go forth and just pray. I felt also the Lord said those who are dealing with anger issues, we want to pray with you this afternoon. This is our 40-day ending the consecration. How many are excited? How many got some suddenlies? I got some suddenlies during the 40-day consecration. What you got was a suddenly. Amen, Brother Tidwell. Hope I'm saying it right. That was a suddenly God did it. So along with that, I really want to celebrate today. And the song that's on my heart when I think about Jesus and what he's done for me, I don't know if you go there, Brianna. When I think about Jesus and how he set me free, now y'all know I'm ready to dance every chance I get. So. But I'm going to dance today. Brother Wayne, you said you wanted to dance. I'm going to take care of your word. You didn't say it. I thought you said it. Brother Tidwell, I know you can go in. Where's my other dancer? I saw that young man with the ponytail. I know he can go in back here by behind Alicia. Hallelujah. Why y'all laughing? I want to celebrate. Thank you, Jesus. I want to acknowledge my student, Stan LaShannon. She's a student at the School of Prayer. She's looking for a church hall pastor. Her and her son, is that your son with you? They're looking for a church home. We're so happy they came today. Let's show them that Northside Christian Center, where Jesus is Lord, hey, hallelujah, Christ is center, is a place to celebrate. How many can say, there's my dancer, that young man right there. Somebody say it's in the house. It's in the house. believe that God will do, hallelujah, something miraculous on next Sunday. How many will touch and agree with me? Amen. That on next Sunday, you will have a powerful resurrection Sunday. We're asking everybody to come back and bring someone. Amen. We want to continue our prayer on tomorrow night. Sister Pearl Dorsey will be bringing a word on tomorrow. The widow's persistent. The persistent will. We need to learn how to be persistent in prayer and in the things of God. So she'll be bringing that message on tomorrow night. Amen. We're so happy for everyone that's here today. Just lift your hands one more time and give God praise.
So happy to have both of them. Just want to have a word from them before the service is over.
Since he invited me down here, give a quick word. We have a sister here dealing in prayer. We live in a time now where we really need a lot of prayer. But like you said, we can sit here and people can be smiling and you never know what's going on in the inside. So God gave you a way that you can address that. If I come up to a sister here and say, how you doing? She's going to say fine. That's not addressing what's going on inside of you. So why should I go up to her and ask her something that she's not going to tell me about anyway? So God told me during this time, when we really need prayer, when we really need each other, show. 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 Speaking to each other's lives. Shalom. Shalom, brother. Shalom. Instead of saying, how you doing? Speak into their lives. Shalom. We see it as peace, but it goes deeper than that. It means nothing missing, nothing broken. So whatever's going on in the inside of that person, shalom. 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 Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'm just so glad to be here today. I'm usually not one that would come up and say anything, but the Lord kept telling me things during the service. And he just said, look at me, what I have done. And I look at you all and I see growth. You know, so God, they think God doesn't change, but God always has things to grow. And I see growth here. And I just wanted to, and I'm so proud to see it. It's just overwhelming, and I just wanted to let you all know that. Amen.
Word from God, word from God. Confirmation, confirmation. God is good. All right, sister. Brianna, there's another single that just came back from Colorado. You know her? And this is another single over here. Come down, my friend. I have your number and name. Yeah. See this sister here? Keep your eyes on her. She's anointed. She's anointed. How many believe that we are getting approaching a choir, a mass choir? Praise and worship choir. Won't it be good at my early 40 marks? Is everybody singing like those six this morning? All right. Anything else you want to do for you? Now we the grace of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost rest and abide with us now, henceforth, and forever. Everybody say, amen.
Amen.
All right. Praise God.